word out that we're on and ready to go.
Yeah, and we're excited that you are here. If this is your first time, or if you've been here for a while but you haven't gotten connected yet, we want you to get connected, right? Like, we all want to be connected to things, and so we have a place for that to happen. The welcome desk is right outside of the pack doors that you guys can go to get connected. For our online tribe, we're going to be dropping the link for an online connect card, so you guys can connect in that way and someone will be in touch with you. And I think we even have a free t-shirt if it's your first week, so that's there's also, if you've been here for a while but you haven't gotten into a smaller group to serve at, there's lots of opportunities for that. So we'll be dropping that as well. You can always email connect@mosaicneo.org to be able to get connected to serve somewhere. We can find a spot that works for you. And hey, also follow us on Facebook, Instagram. That way you're up to date on the most recent announcements, as well as all the information, stuff going on, the exciting things happening here at Mosaic.
Yeah. So just wanted to give some quick hellos. Good morning to Carla. We see you watching. Hey, wait, Kristen Tyson. Oh, isn't that your mom?
That's my mom.
Hey, Mom. What's going on, Mom? And then in a pack, there are people watching as well. So good morning to you. And Luke, you know who you are. You're supposed to be doing announcements with me right now, but maybe next time. I'll get you. So this week, I'm so excited. As a small group leader here,
right,
we are starting small groups this week.
Yes.
So signups are open. You can go to our website. All of our group leaders are listed there. Mm-hmm. We have some new groups. So even if you were in a group, we're asking that you sign up for groups. If you want a new group, want to try out new leaders, all those things, the website is open.
Cool.
If you're here in the building, you can go to the Welcome Center, and there's a QR code that you can sign up. You know, groups is the nucleus of who we are and where we get connected. So just so incredibly excited to do that.
I think what I'm excited about for groups is, like, we get to do this with a congregation every week, but I want to get into smaller groups of people and be able to dig in to life a little bit deeper and dig into the word. And
and it's going to be awesome. This semester we will be doing sermon questions.
Cool.
So really everything that Pastor Adam is doing in the worship experience, we're going to be talking about in groups. So excited. Sign up. Also, Thursday, October 21st. Big event. We're always doing events, but that's who we are. Scare on the Square is happening in downtown Wadsworth on October 21st, and we're going to be a big part of that event. Our doors will be open. We're going to have kids coming in for trick-or-treating.
Right.
We're going to have people out there dancing. Have you worked on the Thriller?
I mean, I'm working on it a little bit, but...
Okay.
Yeah.
We're doing that,
what
too.
What are we doing to the pack? It's being transformed.
It's turning into Candyland.
Yes!
I'm so excited. That was, like, one of my favorite games growing up.
Right.
So, this will not be Mosaic, the building. It will be Candyland. But to make that happen, we need all hands on deck.
Right.
So, if you have the opportunity, there are sign-ups at the Welcome Center, and you can sign up to help on October 21st. There's different shifts. You can also sign up on the website as well, but we really, really need your help, and hope that you can be there with us for this awesome event.
Yeah, we're really, I see the love. I see the love in our online tribe.
Keep the hearts coming.
It's great. Hey, so in order for us to do these events, we believe in something here called radical generosity, right? Which is that we can give our time, our talents, our resources to the church to bless others. And Mosaic is a church for people that don't think church is for them. And so to be able to have an event that we can do here, like, that's where a lot of our resources go to. And so it's really important. If you've been here for a while, this is a great way to give back to the church in an abundance of what God has given us. So there are two different ways you can give. You can give online, which I'll be dropping the link for our online tribe. You can also give in person with our giving boxes that are at the back of the pack. So when you leave, on your way out, there are some boxes that say give, and that's a great way to just share, so that way we can continue to reach the world with the gospel and the freedom and the truth of who Jesus is.
That's right. So it looks like we got some new names here today too online. So
awesome.
Good morning, Wendy. Good to see you. Thanks for the hearts, Carla. And keep sharing it because it's going to be a great time this morning. So I think our worship experience is about to begin.
Yeah.
I get pumped every time.
I know. I even sat through it the first time.
I know.
And I'm excited for it again.
So excited to be here.
Yes.
Again, excited to have you guys online and inside.
Right.
We're going to start our worship experience now.
And so if you're online, make sure you're chatting with us during the worship experience. We're going to be on the whole time, and we're expectant for what God is going to do today.
Keep the hearts coming.
hands, Dave. Let's get on our feet. Let's sing this morning. Come on. Knock on the way. Wait for the walls to fall. Not knowing a name that will bring them down. And I've got a praise waking within my soul. I'm not ashamed to declare it now. Light of the world, trample the darkness. Nothing can stop it. You are the God of the promise. Every word will be accomplished. Nothing can stop it. You are the God of the promise. Clear the way, the King of glory comes. Before his name, every fear must bow. Chains, Jesus destroyed them all. Up from the grave, he is with us now. Light of the world, tremble the darkness. Nothing can stop it. You are the God of the promise. Every word will be accomplished. Come on, church, let's sing this out together.
The gates of hell will never stand a chance. Your name prevails. Jesus, the great I am. No word will fail. No weapon formed against. Your name prevails. Jesus, the great. Oh,
God. Amen. He is so worthy.
Do you feel the shadows deepen? Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? Do you wish that you could see it all made new? Is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? And is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of?
Pray with me. Jesus, we're so grateful that you are worthy. Lord, I pray that those praises made it all the way up out of this reality and into the spiritual to your throne room, Lord. I pray for every person in here right now, Lord, that all the distractions that happen in our head as we sit in an experience like this, Lord, I pray that you would calm those, that we'd be able to hear your voice this morning. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, you can have a seat. Thank you, worship team. Couple things as we're getting started here. One is just an observation. So we did end up, I don't know if you guys noticed, we like gave away a trip to Disney last week. It was pretty wild. They did a thing on Facebook with it, and they shot confetti everywhere, and it's mostly clean, but I realized there's one place they didn't think to clean. It's right above me. There's just a couple of pieces, so as I'm preaching, sometimes confetti just falls, and that's, I just think it's God saying amen as I'm going. My second thing, and you guys are already doing better, I just wanted to, so as a preacher, it's really weird, like people will, you get evaluated. You know, as an introvert, this is wild to be up here speaking to you and have people like deciding whether or not they like what you're saying, like what you're wearing, how you're saying it, how you're wearing, all this stuff. Super weird. So I thought I'd flip the script on you today and let you know that I'm evaluating you as an audience. Okay? So I told you last week, I told First Service that they did really good. You know, I give them a good grade. So here's two things. If maybe you're not familiar with church, like I just want you to know, like if I say something funny, I do actually expect you to laugh. Like that's a big deal to me. And I told them the problem is if you don't, I will keep trying to make you laugh and it'll get worse because the jokes get worse as I go. So just laugh at the first one. It's better for everybody. And then secondly, if I say something good, you're allowed to like say amen. We're not like a crazy wild church where you're going to like shout me down, but you're allowed to like acknowledge that something good has been said or truth has been spoken. You're allowed to interact with me just a little bit. Don't stand up and talk because there's people here in the audience who will drag you out of here. I'm not kidding. Feel safer because of that, right? Okay. All right, so today we're going to talk about the most iconic story in the Bible besides Christmas and Easter story. Those two are at the top, but this one, it's up there. One of the most well-known. And because of that, I'm going to make an assumption that I don't normally make here at Mosaic. I'm going to assume that you know the story. You definitely know how it ends. You might not know all the details, but the story is David and Goliath. The iconic, classic underdog story. Just a kid from Bethlehem going up against the champion of the Philistines, right? The shepherd boy going up against the battle-hardened warrior. It's slingshot versus sword. It's small versus big. It's faith versus fear. It's that story that we all kind of grab on to, right? It really is iconic, and I think there's a reason that we all love this story. There's a reason we're all drawn to this story. There's a reason this story is so well known. It's because this story really resonates with us. We love this story because every single one of us has faced or is facing something bigger than us in our life, right? We all have things and maybe multiple things that you're facing right now that you just kind of feel outmatched. You feel like they're bigger than you. Whether it's in your relationships, you just don't know what to do, or your financial situation, you feel stuck, or something at work, or something in life, some mountain you can't climb, some problem you can't solve, and you have those things that just feel bigger than you. And when you read this story, you get to see something where just because the thing is bigger than you doesn't mean it wins. And we like that. We like to be able to see that on display. So what I want to do is I want to look at this familiar story, and I want to zoom in on a couple of details that maybe aren't as familiar and help us learn some stuff about the things we're facing that are bigger than us. So let me set the stage for you. There is a battle going on between the Israelites and the Philistines, and the way it's happening is the Israelites are on a hill on one side, and the Philistines are on a hill on the other side, and there's a valley between them. And the Philistines have decided to send out a champion to challenge the armies of Israel. And he walks down the hill, and he bellows out over the valley this challenge. And this was a pretty common practice in ancient warfare, where one army would send their best guy to challenge the other army's best guy, and whoever won that little duel would win the battle. It's a little better way to do it than conventional warfare where there's a lot of bloodshed, a lot of life lost. They could handle their stuff by just having two guys fight. So that's what was happening. There was this challenge being issued from the Philistine side, like, hey, send your best guy. The only problem was who the Philistines were sending. This guy, this champion of the Philistines, was a monster. The story tells us that he was 9 foot 9 inches tall. He was almost as tall as a basketball hoop. That dude was just a freak of nature. He carried a spear that weighed 30 pounds. Can you just imagine the oomph that would hit with if he connected? His armor weighed over 200 pounds. He was huge. He was like, on paper, the perfect soldier. And as big as he was, he had an ego to match. He thinks he is invincible, and his taunting and jeering at the Israelites proves it. So every day for 40 days, he comes out and makes this challenge. Cue David, our hero. He was off in the pasture watching sheep. His dad sends him to bring some food to his brothers and captains. So he's bringing in some bread and cheese for the people he knows at the front lines. So he's kind of there now, and now we're going to pick up the story in 1 Samuel chapter 17. I will start in verse 25. Have you seen the giant? The men asked. He comes out every day to defy Israel. The king has offered a huge reward to anyone who kills him. He will give that man one of his daughters for a wife, and the man's entire family will be exempt from paying taxes. That's a pretty good reward, right? Kind of weird to offer your daughter, but whatever. We can talk about that later. 26, David asked the soldiers standing nearby, what will a man get for killing the Philistines and ending the defiance of Israel? So he's clarifying. He's like, wait a minute, did I really hear that right? And then he continues, who is this pagan Philistine anyway that he's allowed to defy the armies of the living God? And these men gave David the same reply. They said, yes, that is the reward for killing him. So David kind of jumps onto the scene here. Keep in mind, I don't know if you ever been in a situation where like working on something, and then somebody shows up and goes, hey, did you try that? And you kind of want to go, like, shut up. Of course we thought about that, right? You ever been there? That's kind of the situation here. So I understand how some guys are a little bit annoyed at David for wandering in and saying, hold up, this dude's been mouthing off for 40 days. Why aren't you guys doing anything about it? So David's kind of incredulous, kind of ticked off, but he's also intrigued because he's kind of got two things going on, right? Number one, there's a reward. Wait a minute, what? Which daughter, right? and then two, I don't have to pay tax. My whole family doesn't have to pay tax anymore. Like, okay, you have my attention. But David also is in this place where I almost feel like with the way he asks, he's frustrated that there even has to be a reward. You know what I'm saying? Like, he's like, wait a minute, this guy's mouthing off. Why isn't anybody just taking care of him? Why have we gotten to the point where there has to be a reward for this? Shouldn't somebody just be doing it anyways? So that's kind of the attitude he's come in with. He's asking around. So he's asking a lot of questions. He's getting a lot of the same answers. He's just confirming that he's getting the truth. And then verse 28 happens. So he's making his way around asking this question. But when David's older brother Eliab heard David talking to the men, he was angry. What are you doing around here anyway, he demanded. What about those few sheep you're supposed to be taking care of? I know about your pride and your deceit. You just want to see the battle. Okay, so Eliab coming in hot, right? He is being that mean bully of an older brother here. So I want to stop for a minute, kind of back up and look at the whole story. Since you know the story, I don't feel like I'm like ruining everything. You know that Goliath loses, right? Like, you already know that. So if I let that slip, it's not like a spoiler where you're like, oh, great, man, thanks. You already knew that, right? So I'm going to kind of back up and look at the whole story as we go. I want you to know that, you know, David goes to fight this giant. But up until the moment he steps onto the battlefield, nobody supports him in that. Nobody. You know, you go back to his dad. His dad sent him to the battle lines. But they're like, that was like an ancient version of a DoorDash, right? Like, he's just sending him with, here, feed your brothers. Like, that, it wasn't like, he wasn't hoping, hey, go kill a giant today, buddy. Like, no, he was just, go take food to your brothers and then come back and watch these sheep. So his dad wasn't supporting him. We'll learn here in a minute that Saul definitely doesn't support. Saul, like, begrudgingly allows him to go fight the giant, but Saul's not supporting him. And here we definitely see Eliab, who is actually kind of hostile against him even being there, even asking questions. So nobody supports David in this endeavor. I just kind of wanted to ask, have you ever noticed that the biggest opposition you face in your life sometimes comes from people who are supposed to be on your side? You ever notice that? Where you You already have a lot going on. Maybe you have some actual enemies or things that feel like enemies. But really, the biggest opposition you face is from people who are supposed to be standing in your corner. I mean, it's one thing to handle a hater, right? It's another thing to handle a hater who's supposed to be a helper, somebody who's supposed to be on your side, right? A hater, you can just shake it off, right? Taylor Swift, 2014, shake it off. Like, you just do that, right? You go ahead, you turn that up, and you play that song, and you can do that. But with somebody who's supposed to be on your side, you can't really shake them off, right? Or at least you probably shouldn't. You have to handle them a little bit different. What do you do with a helper who's functioning like a hater? Well, to answer that, I think we got to look at some possible reasons why they would act that way. Why would somebody not support you who's supposed to support you? Why would somebody demoralize you when they're supposed to encourage you? Like, why would that be the situation? We have a couple of examples in this story, so it's kind of cool. You have Saul and you have Eliab, and they're both, they're different, but they have some similarities. So there's this detail that you don't see in this story. You have to kind of read some other stories to gather this information, but they have something in common. Eliab and Saul have something in common. And it doesn't seem like an important detail, but it is an important detail. Eliab and Saul are both tall. They're both tall. That's seems like an irrelevant detail, but I promise it's important. So just to let you know how we know this, when Saul becomes king, Samuel points out that he is head and shoulders above everyone in Israel. So Saul is a big dude. Okay, everybody's looking up literally to Saul in Israel. And then when David was crowned king, if you remember last week, when David's crowned king, remember that really important verse where God says, hey, I look at the heart? Well, God also said to Samuel, hey, don't look at his appearance or his height, which kind of implies, yes, he's also big, Samuel. I get that he's tall, but don't look at that. So both Saul and Eliab are tall. Saul is the giant of Israel. Eliab is at least the giant of his family, okay? So when these ancient duels happened, when the one side would send their champion out, the expectation was, hey, we're sending our biggest guy. You guys send your biggest guy, right? That was the argument. Hey, we're going to send our biggest, toughest guy. You send your biggest, toughest guy, and we're going to fight. So when Goliath walks down the hill to issue the challenge, who do you think's hearing it? I think everybody's kind of looking around going, well, our giant is Saul, right? Now, if I'm Saul, you could probably get out of this pretty easy, right? Listen, guys, I'm king. You need me. You don't want me to go down and fight that guy. I should probably not be the one to go and fight, even though I'm bigger than all of you. You need me. I'm king. So maybe Saul weaseled his way out of this thing, which means then it would drop down to the next biggest guys, right? So Eliab also has to be feeling this pressure. Every time this taunt, this challenge is issued, you know, the soldiers start murmuring, who's going to do it? Who's going to go fight this guy? Who's going to go risk their life? And then they start talking, well, you know, Eliab's pretty big. Why ain't he doing anything? Yeah, it was Saul said no. So they're getting all that murmuring, all that pressure's kind of building up over here. And what I want you to see is I think that Saul and Eliab are both dealing with their own insecurities in this. The biggest guy from one army is challenging the biggest guy in the other army, and both of them are towards the top of the list. They should be going to fight. They should be volunteering. But they're not. So the fact that David is willing shines light on their unwillingness, right? Eliab's accusations are actually projections of his own insecurities. David's not those things, he is. So I want you to see sometimes when you step up in your life, when you step into something, when God calls you to something big, when you feel God tugging on your heart towards something, sometimes what that does is it shines light on the people who are on your side, in your corner. It shines light on the fact that they haven't stepped out yet. Because your bravery is shining light on their cowardice. Your faith is shining light on their doubts. Your action is shining light on their passivity. Your willingness to fight your giant is shining light on their unwillingness to fight their own. So, well, a couple things. Like, I guess, I don't know, is that, hopefully that's helpful. To be able to realize that the reason someone is opposing you actually kind of has nothing to do with you, that it's not about you, it's actually about them and their own insecurities. I don't know if that gives you a little empathy. Maybe it makes you more frustrated at them. I don't know. But for me, that's helpful to say, hey, it's not about me and what I'm trying to do or what I feel called to do. It's actually about your own insecurities, your own hangups. And maybe for you, you're like, gosh, I already have a hard enough time fighting my own insecurities. You're telling me I have to fight somebody else's too? Yep, you do. And maybe some of you are in that place right now. Like, I feel like, forgive me for the pastor speak, but I feel like God's doing something. And there's a lot of people here who maybe you're starting to take steps of faith in your life. You're starting to maybe take this whole God thing a little more serious, this whole faith thing a little more serious, this whole church thing a little more serious. And you maybe want to start to step out, but there's going to be people who are in your corner and want to support you who are going to hesitate. And then they're maybe going to want to pull you back too, because it's safer for them if you stay back too. Because the moment you step forward, they're going to feel this weird pressure like they have to as well. And I just wanted to point that out, because sometimes that's an awkward, weird feeling, and maybe you need to engage that. Maybe you need to have a conversation here, because sometimes that happens. But just keep in mind, it's not really about you. It's not really about you. Check out this Charles Spurgeon quote, famous pastor from the past. He says this: "Many a man meets with more trouble from his friends than from his enemies. And when he has learned to overcome the depressing influence of prudent friends, he will make short work of the opposition of avowed adversaries." I love that 150-year-old wisdom there. This is just a way of saying things back then. I love the line, "the depressing influence of prudent friends." Anybody have some prudent friends in their life? And he's saying, hey, sometimes the hardest fight doesn't happen on the battlefield. The hardest fight is to even get onto the battlefield. And once you're on the battlefield, actually, that fight's pretty easy. So I think, I don't know, for me, I think about my past and how I've, the influences I've had. Like even for this church, I've really enjoyed being a part of this church because by and large, I don't have a lot of prudent friends. I have friends who also like to fight giants here. So our staff, our volunteers here, we tend to like to try things that are probably a little bigger than we should try to do as a church. And I love that we're willing to do that together. And I don't know, there's something about being in a group of people who all collectively kind of want to do that. The moment you throw a crazy idea out there, they're like, instead of going, oh, that's crazy, that's stupid, you shouldn't try that. We have a lot of people here who want to go, they smell that battle and they want to go fight it. And I love that. So if you want to be a part of a church with people who are a little bit crazy, that's us. That's us. So how do we deal with these people, though? How do you deal with the people in your corner who maybe you even recognize it's their insecurities, it's their hangups that are causing them to want to hold you back? They're holding themselves back, and they want to hold you back. How do you deal with that? The cool part in this story is that David deals with each of the two guys who do that in the story, he deals with them differently. So Eliab, he deals with one way. Saul, he deals with a different way. So let's see his reaction to Eliab. So remember, Eliab came at him hot. Here's how David responds, verse 29. "What have I done now?" David replied. "I was only asking a question." And he walked over to some others and asked them the same thing and received the same answer. Then David's question was reported to King Saul, and the king sent for him. So the interaction with Eliab is actually pretty short. Eliab comes in emotional, hot, angry, accusatory. David says two sentences and walks away. He doesn't even engage him. He completely diffuses the thing. Kind of, you almost get the impression that he puts his hands up when he's speaking, like, dude, what? Like, don't shoot, man. I don't know why you're here. I don't want any part of this. And he walks away. So I want to say sometimes there's wisdom in not getting engaged with a battle of words. And this is true whether we're talking about somebody supporting you in an endeavor or just any general human interaction. I think you need some wisdom in how much heat is in the situation before you go and respond, right? Sometimes it's better to not hit send on that text. Sometimes it's better not to hit post on that Facebook comment, right? Sometimes it's better to not hit send on that phone call. Sometimes it's better just let the situation cool down before you move on it. Now, I used to be really bad at this. So my mentor, he's been my mentor for over a decade now, and he used to tell me consistently, like, so sometimes, you know, you want to send the email. The email is the best way to do it, because that way you can write something that's, you know, they got to scroll to get to all of it. That's how I want to overwhelm you with information and words, and just, you know, I want you to be impressed with my general knowledge. I'll have footnotes. If I really want to impress you, I can really do something there. You're not impressed at all. Okay, I know how to do footnotes too. That should also be impressive. But I would come up with the, you know, I'd get real angry about something and I'd want to send this email, I'd want to fire it off, and he would say, hey, go ahead and write it out, but just don't hit send. Write it and then let it cool down. Read it in a couple of days. And then, you know, see what you feel. So I've done that a couple of times in my life, and without fail, every time I get to the email later, I read it. And it's funny because when I wrote it, I always feel like, no, I wasn't emotional. This is just truth here. What are you talking about, man? I got all this stuff. This is pure truth. It has nothing to do with emotion. And then 2 days later, I read it. I'm like, you idiot. Like, you were totally crazy. And you didn't think you were crazy in the moment. But here, 2 days later, you've cooled off. And now you know that you were crazy. And more often than not only did I, like, not edit it, I'd barely even sent them. I never sent those emails. I would never do it. So I think that just shows sometimes when you hit those times where somebody comes at you hot, like Eliab did, my response is, oh, you're a level 9? Let me show you what 10 looks like, right? That's kind of my instinct, is I want to come over the top of you with you. And David could have done that, right? He could have said, oh, really, Eliab? You think I'm the deceit? You think I'm just here to watch the battle? Seems like maybe you should be doing something. Maybe you're just here to watch the battle. Shouldn't you be fighting it, by the way? Like, he could have went at him. He could have called him out for his cowardice. But instead, he says two sentences, and he walks away. So I think sometimes that's the wise thing, is to just let the thing cool off and get some separation. Proverbs 15:1 says, a gentle answer deflects anger, but harsh words make temper flare. Your response to their response can really dictate how the conversation goes, how the interaction goes. So he walks away from Eliab, but Saul, he's going to have a totally different game plan. So you can't deal with every person the same, right? There's nuance here. We can't just say, oh, this is how you deal with a person in this. No, you got to read the situation. You got to have a little more details going into the brain before you decide what you're going to do. So he ignores Eliab. He engages Saul. Here's what he says to Saul when he gets to him, verse 32. Don't worry about this Philistine, David told Saul. I'll go fight him. Don't be ridiculous, Saul replied. There's no way you can fight this Philistine and possibly win. You're only a boy, and he's been a man of war since his youth. So David comes at Saul and he says, hey, that thing you're worried about, don't worry about it, because I'm going to take care of it, dude. I got this. I'm going to go fight that guy. Now, Saul says, nah, you're not, because that's crazy. But did you read Saul's reasoning? Because it's like always, like, I don't know, you read a story like this and you have some assumptions about the way people think about this, but did you see his reason for David not to tell David not to go fight? He did not say, hey, that dude's huge. He said, nah, he's older than you. That's weird, isn't it? Like, what? No, oh, dude, David, he's literally twice your size. You'd get crushed like a bug. No, he says, he's got like 10 years experience on you. Maybe you should like not do that. Like, that's a weird reason, right? And I think this just shows that Saul's kind of twisted here. Saul's all upside down. Saul's not in his right mind. He can't come up with a good reason for him not to go fight Goliath, and he can't come up with a good reason for David to either. So he's just all kinds of messed up in the head. So David responds to Saul's little, you're not experienced enough to take on a giant. We actually looked at his response last week, if you were here. And what David does, since Saul goes about experience, he doesn't talk about how big the Goliath is. He talks about his experience. David says, okay, I don't have battle experience, you're right, but I do have life-threatening situation experience. So he shares with Saul this lions and these bears that coming to try and steal his sheep and how he acted in those situations, how he fought off these wild animals. And then we'll read the end of it, verse 36 and 37. Here's what David ends his little speech to Saul. I have done this to both lions and bears, and I'll do it to this pagan Philistine too, for he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the claws of the lion and the bear will rescue me from this Philistine. That's pretty cool. You read that and you're just like, man, I don't know about you. Whenever I read stuff like that, I'm always like, I just want to be like him. I'm not. But man, I really want to be like him with that. What confidence to be having to fight people to go fight a giant. He had to fight before he fought. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's crazy. And this shows, his response to Saul here shows an important skill that Christians need to develop. David draws a connection, a comparison between the lion and the bear victories in this Goliath fight that he's facing. He has a connection here. And he chooses to focus on the similarities between the two situations rather than the differences between those two situations. Because it's tempting. If I'm David in this situation, let me be honest with you. If I'm David in this situation and I have, in some crazy way, God has helped me kill lions and bears in my past, if that was true of me, and then in my present I'm facing a giant, it would be really hard I think I would be tempted to think, well, God did help me with the lion and the bear, but man, this is different. Goliath is a whole different kind of monster. I'm a little worried that even though God helped me with that, maybe he's not going to help me with this. That would have been my honest response. You know how I know? Because I do it all the time, right? God has been faithful to me in my past in many different ways. God has come through. I've faced things that are bigger than me. I've faced things that I've worried about, and God has come through. God has been faithful in my past. I get to my present. I face a new thing, and I go, I don't know if God's going to show up this time. How stupid is that? But it's so easy to think about the differences between the way God has showed up in the past and the way you need him to show up in your present. And David's like, no, I'm going to point out the similarities. That God has saved me here, he saved me here. I believe he's going to save me here. I think that's a skill we can develop. If you're a Christian and you know that God has come through for you in your past, you need to be able to mentally fight that fight to draw the comparisons between what he's done in your past and what you believe he'll do in your present and in your future. So here's what I suggest. Some early morning, when you can get a quiet moment, you know, away from kids, if you have them, you need to get away from them sometimes, amen. If you don't have kids, your life is really easy. I just want to point that out. That's not even a joke. I really do believe that. And if you're an empty nester, you know, you should be saying amen the loudest because you know, hopefully you remember. Anyways, we don't want to talk about that. Thank you. Where are you guys at? You're supposed to help me here. Find a quiet time when nobody else is around. And you need to mentally go back through your life and think about all those situations. Try to remember all those situations in your past where you didn't know if God was going to come through. You didn't know what was going to happen. And somehow God comes through. Somehow God solves the problem. Somehow God provides the thing. Somehow God does something. And I know he did because guess what? You're sitting here right now, right? So I know God has done some things in your past, right? You're here. You're not dead. You're sitting next to somebody. Some of you, like, there's a lot of things that God has done in your life, and you need to write these out. Whether if you're a writing person, put it into some journal somewhere. If you're not, put it in a note in your phone. And then next time you're faced with some big thing, pull that thing out and go through and look at all the times God has come through for you. And remind yourself of his faithfulness and how many times God has come through, and then look at the big thing that you're facing now and go, this is not any different, just like David did. Stare it down and remind yourself of how God has been faithful in your past. So David's really good at this. He's making this connection. So this little conversation with Saul, like I said, ignored Eliab, engaged Saul, and he convinces Saul. Now, you could debate why Saul lets him go, right? You could totally say that Saul is okay with him going because finally Saul can say, at least I don't have to go now, right? You could totally make that argument. But one way or another, Saul allows David to go fight. Now, a little detail in the story we're going to skip is Saul tries to get David his armor, and David refuses because he's not going to go fight in a fight for his life in something he's never worn before. He literally says, I'm not used to this. I'm not going to go fight something I'm not used to. So he puts the armor aside, and instead his preparation looks like this in verse 40. He picked up 5 smooth stones from a stream and put them into his shepherd's bag. Then, armed only with his shepherd's staff and sling, he started across the valley to fight the Philistine. So no armor, no sword, just a staff and a sling. That's David's speed now. That's who David is. He's ready for that. Now, that little verse we just read, there's a question people ask about it. We got hung up on this week. Searching the internets. Why did he pick up 5 stones? Why 5? It's a nerdy Bible question to ask, right? Why 5? So I got all kinds of answers. Don't look it up. It's dumb. One guy, this is an outlier, he goes, he picked up 5 stones because they represent the 5 books of the Torah, and it showed how much David trusted in God's law. And I'm like, dude, you're reaching, man. Where would you get that in the story? Like, that's just crazy to come up with some symbolic reason. Another one, this one's super popular. They said David grabbed 5 stones because Goliath had 4 brothers. Ooh, now that's sweet, right? That's like a baller reason right there. Can't you just see like a movie? Like, somebody's got to make a movie about that. where, you know, they always add characters in the movie, like he's down getting stones and he picks up five and some little boy's like, David, why are you getting five? And David's like, in case his brothers show up, and then he walks off. Like, and it would be Sylvester Stallone. I don't know why, but it was. Did you hear that? He's old now. He wouldn't be able to do it, but it should have been. That would have been so cool. That's like the ancient version of having an explosion happen behind you and not looking back, right? Like, I've got five stones, there's five giants. Why are you asking, right? But can I just, okay, that would be cool. And I don't know. Because you have to really dig into the Bible story to find out that that Goliath has four brothers. And they do come into play later. But can I give like a more obvious reason why he picked up five? Maybe it's because he thought he might miss. Am I allowed to say that? Somebody's like, no, David had faith, right? He had faith. Okay, picking up five stones, does that mean he doesn't trust God? No, it means he didn't trust his aim, right? That's different. By the way, if you've read the story before, I haven't covered every single verse, but you can go back and check. Nowhere in the story did I read that God promised to take down the giant in one throw. Nowhere did I read that. God didn't promise that. So since God didn't promise that, I can assume that David was prepared for whatever the battle might bring. That did not mean that he didn't have faith. This kind of brings up, I think, an apparent tension we deal with as Christians. And there's kind of, you can almost see Christianity divides itself into two camps sometimes where it feels like you either have faith or you prepare. You either have faith or you plan, but you can't have both, right? And I think that happens a lot with Christianity. I just want to point out that there should not be tension in that. That unless God specifically speaks to you, which would be awesome, by the way, unless God specifically speaks to you and tells you the way he's going to do things, how sure can you be that God's calling you to something? I mean, we could do a whole sermon series on that, of where you feel God pulling you towards something, you're stepping out in faith, but a lot of times you're, I don't know, what, at best 85% sure? Some of you would be like, that would be awesome if I was 85% sure if God wanted me to do something. But you even have to have faith in that. I think that's a part of the process, by the way. If God just tells you it's going to happen, I mean, there's still faith in that, but it's a different kind of faith. When you're praying and trying to follow God's lead and trying to put together, hey, this is what the Bible says, and this is the way my life is, and here's where I feel like the Spirit's leading, and I'm not 100% sure, but hey, God, here's where I'm going. I'm going to walk down into that valley, and I'm going to stare this thing down, and I'm going to take five stones in case I miss with the first four. But does that really mean you don't have faith? You're still fighting the giant. You're still throwing the rocks. I think you're allowed to have faith and plan and prepare. They go hand in hand, and a lot of times I think it's just an excuse to not plan. We're just going to have faith. Okay. There's a certain personality type that loves that, right? We're just going to see what happens and hope God shows up, right? I know there's the other side, and you can plan God right out of your life, but man, I think we're supposed to have both. You're supposed to have faith, take risks for the glory of God, and plan stuff out and be ready for things. They're both there. You don't have to pick one or the other. Okay, let me get off my soapbox. The story continues. David gets his five smooth stones. He's got his sling in one hand. He's got his staff in the other. And he walks across the valley towards a giant. And you got to put yourself in the story. This is, man, for me, this is a big part of the Bible, is you got to imagine what it was like there. I think a lot of times you read it and you kind of stand back from it. For me, I like to imagine being in the story. Can you just imagine he picks up these stones, so they're kind of heavy on his belt. He can feel them rattling against his leg as he walks. He's got the sling in one hand and he's got his staff in the other. He's probably shaking a little bit and he starts walking out across this valley towards this giant. And that's probably not a short walk, right? And that's crazy. His heart had to be racing. You imagine if David was an introvert, I don't know if he was, like all those people watching you, that's a little social anxiety right there. And you know, you introverted people know that the moment you think somebody's watching you, you forget how to walk, right? You look at, am I walking normal? Like you have that weird, like you have to try and figure out how to do it. The introverts know. All the extroverts are like, I don't know what you're talking about, but for real, we think about these things. How do we look? So David's walking across this valley and he's got to be praying. You know, he's got to be in that moment. All right, Lord, I'm doing this. There he is. He's walking towards me. You know, he's getting closer. He doesn't seem so big. And then he gets a little closer. Oh, he is big. You know, you start to get that feeling, start to feel the ground shake as this guy starts coming towards you. Like all that adrenaline, all that stuff would be happening. He'd be sweating through his clothes. He'd be working himself up. He'd be like trying to get into that zone. And then he gets close enough and they have this interaction. Verse 43, Goliath speaks first. "Am I a dog?" he roared at David, "that you come at me with a stick?" And he cursed David by the names of his gods. "Come over here and I'll give your flesh to the birds and the wild animals," Goliath yelled. So Goliath is insulted by David's presence. He's insulted by who David is, what he looks like, even what he's carrying. He's all focused on the staff. He should have been a little more focused on the sling. The staff doesn't want to get him, right? So he's doing some ancient trash talk here, and David absolutely plays right back. Verse 45, David replied to the Philistine, "You come at me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of heaven's armies, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. Today the Lord will conquer you, and I will kill you and cut off your head, and then I will give the dead bodies of your men to the birds and the wild animals. The whole world will know that there is a God in Israel." Verse 47, "And everyone assembled here will know that the Lord rescues his people, not with the sword and the spear. This is the Lord's battle, and he will give you to us." Ooh, that's a good little speech right there. That's a good little speech. I love the part where he says, "The Lord will conquer you, but I'm going to kill you." You know the difference? And we talk about this a lot, but man, that's the way God works, right? Hey, God's going to be the one that does this, but he's going to work through me. Now, a couple details I want to point out before we get to David taking this giant down. And by the way, it's so funny when I get into these stories, since you know that the giant falls, I don't even have the verse in here. David wins, in case you forgot. David wins. But something stands out in the story. If you look at the characters, so take Jesse out. But if you look at Saul, Eliab, Goliath, and David. Those are the four characters we looked at here today. If you think about their mentality in this story, Saul, he was concerned about what Goliath's presence meant to him as a king, right? What does this guy coming out every day for 40 days mean about me as a king, right? That was his main concern. Eliab, his main concern is, what is my little brother going to fight a giant mean to me as the eldest son, right? His focus was on him. Even Goliath, what does it mean about my might as a warrior that they sent a kid with a stick to fight me? But the one who stands out is David. Everything about what David does doesn't have anything to do with David. Have you listened to everything he said in the story? Every time David speaks, he's asking about, hey, what does this Goliath's presence say about God? What is me walking across this valley say about God? The center of David's life was different than everyone else in the story. And I think that's actually the point. I think it's really important that we know that things that are bigger than us can be taken out through the power of God. That's definitely important. But the real point of the story is that David was God-centered and nobody else in the story was. David was concerned about God. So I want to ask that pastoral question. Who is at the center of your life? Why, like, how do you make decisions? Because that's the whole point here. David made this decision to go fight this giant, not because David thought it would make David look good. David wanted to fight that giant because he was concerned about how God looked. He was concerned with God's glory in the situation. So if you're like newer to this whole Christianity thing, you're newer to this whole church thing, this is a really big theme in this faith. That God is at the center, that God is at the top. And it's really important because Christianity doesn't work very well unless God is. And that man, maybe even if you're younger to the faith, this is one of those things that when you become a Christian and you put your faith in Jesus, you still kind of have this like different kind of mentality. And we can put it in a framework. It's one of the things we talk about here all the time. So I think God wants to work in your life in three different ways. God wants to do some things for you. He wants to do some things in you. And he wants to do some things through you. All three of these are important. All three of these are important. So if you take them each in order, God wants to do some things for you. And let's be honest, a lot of prayers fall into that category, right? A lot of prayers fall into that category. And that's okay. God, please do this for me, for me, for me. I don't want to demean that. In a lot of ways, this level, God doing things for you, is the most important. Because the most important thing that ever happened was God doing something for us. You know that. If you're a Christian, you know that. Jesus coming and dying on the cross in our place for sin is the most important thing ever. It's what it means to be a Christian, to put your faith and trust in what Jesus did on that cross. To believe that Jesus died for you is the most important thing you can believe. For you. This level is really important. The problem is, a lot of Christians never get past that. They get stuck in a for me mentality. And if you stay here, there's not like, you know, I have a one-year-old and she acts like a one-year-old. She's allowed to act like a one-year-old because she's a one-year-old, right? She just takes stuff off the table. She knocks, she makes messes. Listen to this. I scrubbed the carpet. I swept and scrubbed the carpet yesterday and my wife let them walk into the living room with saltine crackers. Can you believe that? But listen, you know it's true. She's one, she's allowed to act like a one-year-old, right? I'm not gonna get mad at her for acting like a one-year-old. So if you're newer to the faith, you're allowed to be in this place where, hey, I want God to do things for me. You're allowed to be there. But as you grow, and listen, this is the mentality you have to believe that you're gonna grow to a point where you have to get past that. Not, you're still gonna have that, but you're also gonna add some things to it that sometimes God's gonna wanna do work in you. He's gonna work in you. And that's that next level. He wants to work in your heart, your attitude, your demeanor, your patterns. He wants to change you. He wants to grow you. If you became a Christian and you put your trust in Jesus, then number one, you acknowledge that you had some things wrong with you. That's a prerequisite to putting your trust in Jesus, right? So there's no Christian who's like, I'm good, thanks God. Because the moment you're kind of perfect, guess what? That means you're at the end. And you shouldn't be here anymore. So you have to acknowledge that you have got some things in here that God needs to work on. He wants to do that. And sometimes that thing that you're praying that God would do for you, he's not doing it because he wants to work in you. And he's working on a different level. See how this can mess you up? If you don't have all these, if you don't acknowledge all these levels, it can really mess you up because you're sitting here going, God, why are you doing this for me? And God's like, I've got a couple other levels I'm working on here. If you only live on that level, some stuff's not going to make sense. You're going to ask God, what are you doing a lot? You're going to get a little whiny sometimes. You're going to get a little entitled sometimes if you only live on this first level. But sometimes he wants to use that thing you're praying for to work in you. And then the final level is when you acknowledge that God wants to work through you, through you. God's going to conquer you, but I'm going to kill you. Remember? Yes, God's going to do it, but he's going to do it through me. He's going to work through my arm as I sling that sling around and I let that rock go. God's doing it, but he's using me. This is God's MO. You have to know this is something, as you get to know God a little bit, this is the way he works. This is his pattern throughout all of history. When he wants to do a work on this world, he finds a willing person and he works through them. God wanted Goliath to fall. He didn't send a meteor. He sent a shepherd boy. He didn't send a lightning bolt. He sent a willing servant. Man, that's some of you. You need to know. And maybe that's part of it. I think so many people think that Christianity doesn't work. It's because they never get here, because this is where it really clicks. When you acknowledge that God wants to work through you. Yes, he did some things for you and he's still going to continue. And yes, he's going to work in you. But the for you is when you get yourself out of the center and you start to realize, man, my life isn't actually about me anymore. It's about God and others. It's about how I can serve God and how I can love others. That's when it really starts to click. So man, just imagine with me David's life if he just lived on the first level. Can you imagine that? If David had just sat up on the hill over here and prayed, dear Jesus, no, he wouldn't have, that wouldn't have made any sense. Dear God, sorry, it's a church joke there. What do you mean? Dear God, please take that giant away. What if he had just done that? Dear God, please do this thing for us. Take the giant away. Do something there. What would David's life have looked like if he just lived on that level? What man would he have become? What would have happened in his life? What would have happened in the lives of the people around him if he hadn't been willing to allow God to work, do some work in him to build that courage and that boldness, and if he allowed God to work through him? Man, would he have ever become what he was? How different his life and the lives of others would have been. It was God working in him and through him that it caused him to experience all that he experienced. So maybe if you're facing something bigger than you, you need to put it through this framework. Yes, God wants to do some things for you, and maybe he will take care of this thing. Maybe he'll just snap his fingers and it'll be gone. But maybe he's trying to use that thing that you're praying for to do something in here. Maybe God wants to do some things in you. And then finally, maybe God wants to work through you. Maybe he wants you to use you to be a part of the solution to the thing you're praying for him to get rid of. And maybe, worship team, you guys can come back up here. Maybe the most important thing that I want you to see in this story is that if David had stayed at the for me level, he would have never experienced God moving, and he would have came to a very wrong conclusion. If David had sat up here on this hill and just prayed for God to get rid of the giant, he would have believed that God wasn't present in the story. Because God wasn't going to just kill Goliath on his own. God was going to use somebody to do it. So David actually got to experience God's presence only because he was willing to be a part of what God was doing. How crazy is it that the presence of God was felt more in a valley with a giant than it was up on a hill in safety? And man, maybe that's the thing you need in your life, to be willing to step out onto that battlefield and do something. Open your hands up and say, God, use me. Do something with me. Make it not about me. Make my life not about me anymore. Let me be a part of what you're doing on this earth. Maybe that's the prayer you need to pray. Pray with me. Jesus, I pray for the people in this room right now, Lord, who have something that they're facing that's bigger than them. Man, I pray they would feel your presence in that. That even if it's been there for a long time, they would deep down know that you're trying to do something with it. Maybe you're trying to work in them. Maybe you want to work through them. Lord, I pray that they would have something happen inside of them right now that would acknowledge your presence in the situation and your desire to work in the situation. I pray for the people right now, Lord, who are kind of on the edge of faith in you. Man, I pray they would lean in. I pray they would take that step, Lord, that soul level step towards you. Pray that simple prayer, Lord. I just give you my life. Lord, I pray that somebody would take that step. Jesus, I give you my life. Help us remember all those times you've come through for us and how that means something right now in what we're facing. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Spirit, come.
Pray with me one more time. Jesus, I'm just so thankful for that. Lord, I do pray that your Spirit comes. I do pray that you seal this in our hearts, that it's not one of those things that we walk in and we walk out the same. Lord, that something would stick, that something in our hearts would be changed. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right. Hey, two things, not one thing. First service missed this because I forgot. So two things. We're going to talk here a little bit. You'll hear me often kind of say there's a difference between going to a church and being a part of a church. So I want to give you, let you know there's two opportunities coming here. Right now, today, we started sign-ups for our Mosaic groups. Yeah, some people are excited. Basically, if you don't know what that is, those are small groups that meet in homes. And this semester, so they're going to run for just a certain amount of weeks that I don't know because I'm not prepared for this announcement. But the idea is that they're going to kind of have a discussion about the sermon. So not like how good was it because we already know the answer to those questions. But it's going to be interactive. You're not going to hear another sermon. You get to have a discussion and talk about it. Really important. So being connected in that way is really important. It's one of the things that makes church work. And then the second thing I wanted to give you an opportunity for is on Thursday is Scare on the Square, the thriller thing that's downtown. What is happening? Do you hear that? Okay, thank you. Throwing me. I don't know how to speak with that rhythm happening. Thank you, Steve. So one of the reasons we were excited to move downtown is that the city's going to put events on for us. All we got to do is open up our doors and we'll be here. This one's big. This one, there's thousands of people. I was looking at my phone the other day because I couldn't remember because it was 2 years ago, the last time this happened, but it was awesome. There were thousands of people downtown. Amanda is somewhere. She's right there. She needs volunteers for this. This is one of those ways you can allow God to work through. You can be a part of volunteering in that. Amanda, where should they go if they want to volunteer for that? Out at the Welcome Center. Yes, Welcome Center. If you want to volunteer to be a part of that, it's on Thursday, 5 to 8. We need some people to help us do that. All right, so I hope to see you there. Hey, I just want to tell you, I think you did better today. This was good. Congratulations. I'm clapping for you. See you next week.